Everyone, come on in, have a seat. We want to welcome everyone to the Lincoln Park Church of Christ. If you're worshiping with us at home through our Zoom or downstairs, we're glad that you're joining us today to worship the Lord. There were some technical difficulties with our Zoom connection, as many of you may know. But those have been resolved. And we just want you to know that in the future and going forward, we're going to use the same ID number for Zoom. If there was confusion about that, we want everybody to know that the same link that you used before will be used again. All the issues have been taken care of. If you'll see in the back, there are still some bags back there. And we're asking everybody that can pick up a bag that you can take to someone, because not everyone can come and pick up these bags this year. So if you see a bag back there that has somebody's name on it that you'd like to pay a visit to, or just go by and drop off their cards, we'd be grateful for that, and I'm certain they would too. So just have a look at that table on your way out. We have a number of people today that we need to be reminded to pray for. Dorothy Avis, our sister Dorothy, is she's dealing with some difficult issues in her life, and she would appreciate our prayers. Let's keep Dorothy in our prayers. Our sister Rebecca Vaughn is, of course, the niece of Anita Klaus, is recovering from COVID-19. Let's keep Rebecca in our prayers. And Lloyd and Lydia McClemens, they need our prayers. They're going through a lot of issues, several different issues with their family. So let's keep Lloyd and Lydia in our prayers as well. And we learned this past week that my sister Yvonne's husband, Ernie, has been diagnosed with colitis. Crohn's disease. I thought it was colitis, I'm sorry. Crohn's disease. And I guess it's serious, so. Let's keep Ernie in our prayers and Yvonne in the family as well. Steve handed me this note. His great-great nephew, Jace Barnes, 9 months old, was taken to the hospital in Alabama with high white blood counts. And we don't know yet what that means, but he's at the hospital so that he can discover what's going on with Jace. Let's pray for Jace, 9 months old, can you imagine? And let's keep his family in our prayers. Today's scripture reading comes from Revelation chapter 2 and verse 1 through 7. Revelation chapter 2, the first 7 verses. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, "These are the words of him who holds the 7 stars in his right hand and walks among the 7 golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You have persevered and have endured hardships for my name and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will not come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. I will come to you and remove your lampstand. But if you have this in your favor, you hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God."
Good morning. Our first song of Worship and praise to God in this assembly is number 3. I would ask you to stand and give praise to the Lord. Hallelujah, praise Jehovah. Can't sing hallelujah sitting down, seems like. Hallelujah, praise Jehovah, from the heavens praise His name. Praise Jehovah in the highest, all His angels praise proclaim. All the hosts together praise Him, sun and moon and stars on high. Praise Him, O ye hands of heaven, and ye floods above the skies. Let Him praise, His give Jehovah, for His name alone is high. And His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted far above the earth and sky. Let them praise His gift to Jehovah. They are made at His command. Him forever He established. His decree shall ever stand. From the earth, oh, praise Jehovah. Fire and hail and snow and vapor, stormy winds that hear Him call. Let them praise His gift, Jehovah, for His name alone is high. And His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted far above the earth and sky. All ye fruit, all trees and cedars, all ye hills and mountains high, creeping things and beasts and cattle, entered in the heavens fly. Kings of earth and all ye people, princes, judges all, praise His name, young men and maiden, aged men and children small. Let us praise His gift, Jehovah, for His name alone is high. And His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted far above the earth and sky. Please be seated. We now have opening prayer.
Would you please bow with me? Father, we thank You for all that You've done for us, allowing us to meet together even under these uncertain circumstances. We thank You for all the wonderful things You have provided for us. We thank You for allowing us the opportunity to provide for others. We ask, God, that You would open our hearts and our minds to accept the lesson that we will learn today. We ask that we would be able to use it to further Your kingdom, God. We ask that in this coming year, You would continue to provide for us, continue to provide for others, and to bring ever more people to You. We ask all these things In Jesus' name, amen.
Our song before the Lord's Supper, it was 383, Jesus keep me near the cross. Jesus keep me near the cross, there's a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream. Flows from Calvary's mountain, in the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, a trembling soul, love and mercy found me. There the bright and morning star shed its sweet around me. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, O Lamb of God, bring its scene before me. Help me walk from day to day with its scene goes o'er me. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river.
We have this opportunity to remember why we are here and why we continue to go through our day. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you today, thanking you for the sacrifice that you've given to us, the hope that one day we will be able to be with you in heaven because of the sacrifice that you provided. Be with us as we take this bread. Let us clear our minds and remember what you gave for us. All this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us continue. Heavenly Father, we come to you again, remembering the blood that was shed on the cross, the cruel cross that your Son was hung upon for everyone to witness. We just want to thank you for that sacrifice that you've given. Oh, we're unable to provide anything even close to that and all that so that we can join you one day in heaven, the ultimate sacrifice. Let us take this cup in remembrance of this, and all in Jesus' name, amen. separate from the Lord's Supper, but a convenient time is the opportunity to give back for how we've been blessed. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we get to see in the most sincere sense how truly blessed we are. Even during these difficult times, many of us are still able to be with some that we love and gather here today. Let us give back a small portion of what you've blessed to us that we're unable to even closely give back to you. Heavenly Father, be with those who are sick and keep them safe. And let us continue to remember all of those that are with us and that we're thankful for. And all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
In appreciation for the prayer that Tom just led about contributions, we're so thankful that you've been very active and very consistent in your giving that allows us to continue to help out those who are in need during this time. They have many requests that are coming out because of not being supported properly because of people being out of work, and their needs of people who are in need of food and clothing and shelter, and we've been able to do that. So continue to do what you're doing, and God will continue to bless us with this great opportunities. A song before the lesson. Number 587, sing and be happy. And you can't sing and be happy sometimes when you're sitting, so you please stand for this song. If the skies above you are gray, you are feeling so blue. If the cares and burdens seem gray all the whole day through, there's a silver lining that shines in the heavenly land. Look by faith and see him, my friend, trust in his promises grand. Sing and be happy, press on to the goal. Trust him who leads you, he will keep your soul. Let all be faithful, look to him and pray. Lift your voice and praise him in song. Sing and be happy today. Off we are, trouble and tire, sick and sorrow and pain. There are others living in sin, blessed by earthly gain. Their new courage, we cannot tell what tomorrow may bring. When the dark clouds vanish away, we are truly can sing. Sing and be happy, pressed on to the goal. Trust him who leads you, he will keep your soul. Let all be faithful, look to him and pray. Lift your voice and praise him in song. Sing and be happy today. Oft we fail to see the rainbow up in heaven's fair sky. When it seems a fortunate bird frowning past us by, there are things we know that are worth more than silver and gold. If we hope and hope each day, we shall have pleasures at home. Sing and be happy, press on to the whole. Trust him who leads you, he will keep your soul. Rest on, be faithful, look to him and pray. Lift your voice and praise him in song. sing and be happy today. Thank you. Please be seated. A song of invitation, number 552, 552.
Everyone have a good Christmas? I bet you did. I really wanted a Tesla car for my gift, and I didn't get it. I must have been naughty. I don't know. It's great to be back today. You know, David's not here this morning. He's on vacation, so I want you to be praying for them. He's doing a wonderful job for the congregation here, and we're blessed to have him and Christy and their family here, so we'll continue to pray for them and thank God for their presence among our number. I wonder how many of us were busy shopping this past weeks and realize, I don't know if you heard this announcement or not, but at Walmart, they made an announcement that says, Walmart will be closed Christmas morning so both cashiers can go be home with their families. That's about it, isn't it? They have one cashier, sometimes two. This also was on there. I wonder how many of us make New Year's resolutions. Anyone ever done that? Raise your hand if you've ever done a New Year's resolution. Okay, I think most of us have. And I read this, it said, my goal in 2020 was to lose 15 pounds. Only 20 more to go. That's about it. And this one also. This is so true for me. I signed up for an exercise class and they told me to wear loose-fitting clothes. If I had loose-fitting clothes, I wouldn't have signed up for the class. Oh, it's been a crazy 2020, and yet here we are at the end of 2020. And I want to tell you, if you haven't set any new resolutions for this year or you're thinking about making a change, I want you to encourage yourselves to make sure that you spend more time in God's Word. Get your Bibles out and read them. Karen has a schedule back there under the bulletin board that Fran and I use. I think it'd be good for all of us. You know, read three chapters a day, 15 minutes. Everybody has 15 minutes to spend in God's Word. Three chapters, that's all it takes to go through the Word of God in 2021. So I would encourage you to make that commitment. Fran and I have used a new study Bible that we're going to use. And we always leave it open on the table, the kitchen table, so that we can always have our place in the Bible. And then I have my marker and she has her marker, and I try not to let her get ahead of me. It becomes a contest, you know. We want to make sure we're in God's Word. And I'm telling you, it is a blessing. You'll have a great 2021 if you spend more time in the Word of God. Mark my word. So let's be careful about that. Make sure we're involved. The elders want to encourage the whole congregation to read the Word of God. Change Bibles. If you've been using the same old Bible all the time, change Bibles. I'm going to suggest that Fran and I read the chapters to each other each day just to change things up, you know. And she has a great study Bible. It has a commentary in the margins, and we read those. It's amazing how much you can learn from reading back through God's Word and spending time in the Bible. So let's make that change this year and be committed to reading God's Word. I want us also to remember that the thing about the church is the wonderful issuing of God's Word. I couldn't help but think when Tom was leading us in the Lord's Supper this morning, he said, let's remember what we're here for. Isn't that true? That's why we're here, the Lord's Supper. Acts chapter 20 and verse 7 says, the disciples came together to sing. No, it doesn't say that, does it? It says the disciples came together on the first day of the week to pray. No, it doesn't say that, does it? It says in Acts chapter 20, verse 7, the disciples came together on the first day of the week to hear a sermon. No, it doesn't say that, does it? It says Acts 20, verse 7. The disciples came together on the first day of the week to break bread. Amen? That's why we're here. This is the focal point of our worship. Now, it's good to have singing and the Lord's Supper and also the sermon and prayer and giving, but Let's remember, like Tom said, why we're here. That's the reason. That's the main reason. That's the focal point of our theology. That's what we really want to exercise in our piety. Make sure that we remember the Lord hanging on the cross. There are other reasons that I want you to think about. You know, there's a lot of people that say this. I've heard this. Maybe you've heard this saying. We have to restore the first century church. And I always respond to that in the same way. I always ask a question back. What first century church do you want to restore the Lincoln Park Church of Christ to? Do you want to be like the church in Colossae? Do we want to restore it to the Church of Christ in Colossae that worshiped angels? No, no. Do you want to restore the Lincoln Park Church of Christ to the church in Philippi? No, they were having problems. Do you want to restore the church to the church in Corinth where they had immorality, incest? The Christians were taking their fellow Christians to court. They were just doing horrible things in the church in Corinth. Is that the church you want to restore? No. We want to restore the church that God talks about in his word in Revelation chapter 2. When John wrote this letter to the seven churches of Asia, he was writing to the church at Ephesus, Thyatira, Thessalonica, all those churches because they had problems. Now, he started out talking about the good things in Ephesus and in Revelation chapter 2 that we were reading just a little while ago. And when Ed was reading, I hope you remember, that was a letter to the church in Ephesus. And the first part of that letter in chapter 2, John was proud of that church. He bragged about them. He thought highly of them. He thought they're doing some great things. But he wanted them to know there's areas where you need to be careful. So on your introduction and the outline, if you need an outline, please raise your hand. Jim's going to pass those out to follow along in our sermon this morning. Someone over here, back there. And Revelation chapter 2 and up here, we want to remember the church that John was writing to in Ephesus. And the first thing he mentions in our introduction this morning is the idea that as you look at your lesson or your outline, and I'm going to ask Jim to forward this because it's not forwarding for me. It's on, but it's not forwarding. Maybe hold it up and then I put my tongue in the right way. On your introduction, there are eight categories of things in Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3 which make a great church. And it would be good for us to remember the things that John wrote so that Lincoln Park can be a great church. Don't we want to be a great church? And we want to be the kind of church that the Lord talks about in the New Testament. Oh, thank you, Jim. And so if you really want to become that church, then we need to study Revelation chapter 2 so we can see the kind of church that God wants here at Lincoln Park. That's our effort. That's what we want to do. We want to be a great church like the church was in the first century. So Revelation 2 and 3 is remarkable for its laser-like details for making a great church acceptable to who? To God. We want to be acceptable to God. We don't want to restore the church in Corinth or the church in Colossae or the church in Thessalonica. We want to restore the New Testament churches found in Revelation because that's what God saw that was good about the church and also some of their shortcomings. So the seven churches of ancient Asia received a good report card, including the good and the bad. So you can read what they were doing right, but you can also read about what they were doing wrong. Now, let's face it. We don't have a perfect church at Lincoln Park, do we? Shake your head no. We may never have a perfect church here, but we can improve. And we want to keep that as our goal for 2021. Let's be like the church God writes about in the Bible. Let's restore that church that God told us to restore in the New Testament. So, number one, the first thing he talks about is their works, your labor. I know what you're doing. In fact, he says that in the text. He said, these are the words, I know your deeds. I know what you're doing. I know what the Ephesus church is all about. And he could say the same thing about Lincoln Park. He could say, I know what you're doing at Lincoln Park. I know the good things, and I know the bad things. God pays attention to the church. He knows what we're doing, and he knows what we're not doing. And so this may more immediately relate to the ministry of the Ephesus church and the Lincoln Park church, which had been laborious and diligent, and dignity calls for duty. They knew what they were supposed to do, and those that are stars in Christ's hand needed to always be in motion. He wants a church that's active, that's working, that's involved, dispensing light to all about the American public in our country. And we want ministry involvement. We want people doing things. You know, one of the things that amazes me, every time we go to Europe, our guides have to take us inside the cathedrals and inside the basilicas. And I know Gail will attest to this. Every time you walk into one of those huge cathedrals, Gail, it's amazing, isn't it? It's amazing. You look up and there's gold in the paintings and the windows and the idols they have, the statues of people, and it's just beautiful. You know what's amazing? On Sunday, there's about 15 people in there. 15 people. The church in Europe is dying. They charge you $5 to go in their church to look at their cathedral. Why? Because they don't have any money to run that building. So they have to charge money for people to take a tour of their church buildings in Europe. Isn't that sad? When those churches began, they were churches of movement. Those movements began like the church in the Bible. They were movements. People were involved, but they've turned them into monuments. Walking into those cathedrals is like walking into a cemetery. There's nobody there, and the churches are dying. So let's not go from a movement to a monument. We never want to see a church that's not involved, that's not growing, that's not there. And that's the kind of church God wants. He wants us involved in ministry, in work, in helping people. The second thing we know is that he wants the church pure morally. You know, I'm 67 years old, and I have seen our country get worse and worse morally. We have a moral problem in this country, and it's leaking into the church. And we have to be careful about our morals. It consists very well of Christian patience, not to dispense with sin, not to allow sin into the church. That's what the Lord wants. He wants to make sure that we keep sin out of the church. One of the saddest things is to learn that one of our members is immoral. That's living an adulterous life, a fornication life. And it's been my experience and the other elders here that sometimes you have to go visit people and talk to them about their soul. I tell you, one of the things we're concerned about is people living outside the bounds of marriage, which God's instituted in Genesis chapter 2. And it's sad to go to people, but you have to. You have to go talk to them about the sin in their life and encourage them to come back to the Lord. And, you know, if you ever leave your spouse and you're living with someone else in an adulterous relationship, this is what you're going to hear. You're going to hear me at the door. One of our elders is going to come and visit you. And I always start out the same way, and I say, and I'll just use the word Hezekiah, because I don't think there's a Hezekiah in our church here at Lincoln Park. But Hezekiah, I want to talk to you. And I always ask them, a first thing when I'm at the door is, I need to ask for your forgiveness. I need you to forgive me. And they always say the same thing. Well, what do I need to forgive you for, Russ? I say, I should have been here sooner. I should have been here sooner. Please forgive me. And then I always say this, you know what? You're living with somebody here, aren't you? And he'll say, yeah, I'm living with my girlfriend now. And I'll say, are you married to her? No. What do you think about that? They always say this. Well, they hang their head and they say, I don't think it's right. And I always agree with them. I said, I agree with you. You're right. It's not right. And they always condemn themselves. You don't have to tell them. You don't have to be angry with them. You don't have to scold them. They know they've done wrong. People know when they're living in the wrong relationship. And so we need to make sure that people know when they're living like that, they're going to get a knock on the door. We need to talk to them. Not because we're angry, but we love them and we're concerned about them. And so that's what the church in Ephesus was doing. They made sure that the church stayed morally pure. It wasn't up to God, it's up to us as members. We need to talk to members that are living in sin. We need to address that in a loving way. Let them know what they're doing wrong, because God said, I expect that to happen in the church in Lincoln Park. And you know, I've only had to do it a few times. The last one was down here at Wendy's restaurant. I met the person there because I knew they wouldn't let me come in their home. They would act like they're not home. But you have to. You have to talk to the body to make sure that they stay morally pure. And that's one. Now, will it always work? It won't. It will not always work. But we have to make the attempt. We need to talk to them and see what's going on in their lives so they can stay morally pure. The third thing that God talks to the church is we need to keep correcting false teachers. We need false teachers. 13 years ago, we had to talk to one of our teachers because they weren't teaching right. They weren't teaching scripturally, and they needed to know that. And so we're responsible for making sure that teachers are teaching the truth in our classes. I'll never forget this. I was about 20 years old, I think. Tom, it was way before you lived at Flat Rock Church of Christ, and I was leading singing. And we had a pulpit exchange like we always do every year before the Downriver Life Enrichment Series. And we had a minister come from another church, and he was preaching that night. And he was preaching to the church at Flat Rock that people were possessed by demons and devils, and that they could speak in tongues, so they could heal the sick by laying their hands on people. All these unscriptural things were coming out from 1 Corinthians, and I thought, what am I going to do? I'm the song leader. What should I say? And I was shaking. Let me tell you, I knew it was wrong. It was unscriptural, unbiblical. And I stood up in the pulpit. I was ready to lead the last song. And Brother Phillips, one of our elders, got up from the back of the auditorium, and he walked down the side aisle. I can still see him doing it right now. And he walked up here, and he walked to the microphone at the Lord's Supper table. I was so grateful that one of the elders came forward. And I was almost ready to cry, and I just thanked the Lord. Thank you, Lord. And Jeff Phillips got up in front of the microphone, and he said, we heard two sermons today. This morning's sermon was scriptural. The sermon tonight was unscriptural and unbiblical. And that's all he needed to say. And he said, let's bow our heads together in prayer. And we all bowed our heads together in prayer. And I thank God for Brother Phillips. And then after worship, the elders took the minister into the office to study with him. But you know, we have to be careful about false teaching. Because for some reason, people think that what's coming out of the pulpit and what's in our classrooms is always biblical and scriptural. It's not. We have to be careful about that and watch over it. And anything that comes out that's not wrong, we need to address it. And that's what they did in Ephesus. And that's one of the things that God was grateful for, because this was really happened. True zeal proceeds with discretion. There has to be this casting off of the unfruitful and unscriptural. And some have been risen up in the church that pretended to be ordinary Christians and preachers, but they're not always scriptural, not always biblical. So the church here, the apostle John, was writing to them saying, I'm grateful that you're careful about false teachers. And we need to do that same thing in 2021. He wants us to stay pure scripturally. So watch out for false teachers. That's what he was writing about in Revelation chapter 2. The fourth thing is, he said, I know your perseverance. I know your patience in verse 2. I know that you're there and you're always there and you're dependable. That's the kind of Christians God wants. He wants us to be patient and he wants us to be persevering. He wants us to always be there to endure. One of the greatest things is to see people that continue to work for the Lord, continue to worship, continue to sing, continue to give, continue to assemble for the Lord's Supper, continue to have a good prayer life, continue to read God's Word. That's really where it's at. You know, one of my greatest, the saddest moment in my life is sitting in the auditorium here. And when I was preaching, I used to hear this. People turning pages in their Bibles. We hear a lot of iPhones. You see a lot of iPhones now. And there's nothing wrong with that. Don't get me wrong. Because I know that you can read the Bible out of your iPhone. And I have a Bible app in my iPhone too. But we need to be people of the Bible. Don't ever stop reading the Bible. Don't ever stop being a part of God's Word and realizing what it says to us. Persevere in your Bible study. You know, one of the saddest moments in my life is when I was doing marital counseling, when a couple's having problems. One of the first things I ask them is, how's your prayer life? Number two, you got your Bible. Thank you. That's great. She got a Bible for Christmas. She's holding up her Bible. Number two is, are you reading the Bible? And without exception, every one of those couples that's having problems with their marriage, it's either they're not praying together or they're not reading the Bible. That's usually the crux of almost every problem. Their spiritual life is waning. So the thing that God wants us to do is make sure that we persevere in our Bible study, in our prayers, in our worship. That's the kind of Christians he wanted. And that's what he's writing about here in the church. There has to be that kind of patience that provides for perseverance. And know that this has to be a part of our homes so that when we meet with such difficulties in the way, we'll be able to persevere because we have spiritual ammunition. The fifth thing is keeping our passion. In verses 2 through 4, some of them did not have the passion that they had at the beginning. Haven't you seen that with Christians? They're baptized and they're excited about the Lord. I'll never forget baptizing Kathy at the Flat Rock Church of Christ. And I went to visit her for Bible study. And she said, you can't believe it, Russ. I'm going to convert my whole class at high school. And I said, oh, that's wonderful, Kathy. And I kind of snickered because I knew not everybody's accepting the Word of God. But she was a new Christian. She had passion. She was excited about having Bible studies with people and bringing people to church. That's how she was at the beginning. That's how she was when she came out of the baptistry. So the Lord tells us in verse 2, he wants us to be passionate. And if you aren't, there's a problem. If you're not as passionate when you came out of that baptistry, there's something wrong about yourself. You need to change. And so the first thing he tells us in verse 2 is this, I want you to remember. You see that word in your Bible? Underline that word in your Bible. Remember. Remember. Remember what? Remember how it was in the first, when you came out of the baptistry, when you first gave your life to Christ. Remember. Go back and remember. You had passion. You were excited. You couldn't wait to live for the Lord. That's what he wants us to do. Go back to the passion you had at the beginning. And the second thing he asks us to do, don't just remember, repent. It's not enough to live in the past in your memories. The second thing in verse 2, repent. Underline that word in your Bible. Remember, repent. Repent means in Acts chapter 3, verse 19, repent and turn to God. You've been going this direction in your Christian life. You need to stop it and turn around and go the other way. You've been going the wrong way in your marriage. You need to stop it. Remember how you were in the beginning and repent and go the other way. It's always the same thing. Remember and repent. Those two things. And then the third thing. Do what you did in the beginning. That's the rest of that sentence. Remember, repent, and redo. It's easy to remember, all three R's. Remember, underline those words. Remember, repent, and redo. Some versions just say do what you did at the first. It's redo. That's what we need to do. Don't just remember what it was like in the past, but repent and then do over again what you did first. Get that passion back you had when you came out of the baptistry. That's what he wanted for the church. Go back, recapture it, and redo. That's what he's talking about in regaining your passion. And then number six, he says, maintain genuine love for one another. It's in verse 19. It's a wonderful verse about loving the church, loving the body, love each other. You know what I feel when I come here to Lincoln Park? I feel love. Go up and down the aisles and visit everybody. You don't have to hug each other, but you can look at each other and say, I love you. Nothing wrong with that. If you don't say I love you to somebody, hey, change. Start telling people you love them. Nothing wrong with that. And the church there needed to be reminded of that in verse 19. Charity, either more general, is a disposition of all good men. And you have to regard it as being special. When you're in a household of faith, there is no religion where there is not love. I'm telling you, if we don't have love here, there's no religion. And we're not following God's word. You know, I'm 67. I'm getting old. But I remember a song by the Judds. Some of you may know that singing group, the Judds. They had a song, Love Will Build a Bridge. Do any of you remember that song? Raise your hand if you remember that song. Okay. I really like what that song says. They were very, I think it's a biblical song, really, if you think about it. And I love the way they sang it. They would sing, love will build a bridge between your heart and mine. Love will build a bridge. Don't you think it's time? Don't you think it's time? Everybody. No, I'm just kidding. But it says it. Love will build a bridge. I'm telling you, if you visit a church where there's no love, you'll see it. You'll experience it. You'll notice it. Because we do have love in the Lincoln Park Church, and we want that to continue because that's what God wants for the Lincoln Park Church of Christ. Let's love each other. If he wanted it for the first century church, guess what? He wants it for us too. He wants us to have the love for one another. And then number seven, he tells us we need to keep a strong faith in verse 19. Keep a strong faith. A church that's not strong doesn't have faith. It's not just enough to believe in this world. Don't just believe in Jesus. It needs to go beyond that to having faith. Faith means you're going to be busy. You're going to work. You're going to help people. You're going to take care of people. That's what faith is. You know, I was reading, Gallup polls are wonderful. And so is John McGavran's Gallup polls. He has his own polls for church growth. He said that almost 60% of citizens in the United States believe in Jesus and God. 60%. Isn't that amazing? Did you know that less than 25% of people in the United States go to church every Lord's Day? Isn't that sad? It's one thing to believe in God, but it takes action. He wants us to be busy. He wants us to assemble. He wants us to have the Lord's Supper and sing together and pray together. It takes more than just believing in Jesus and God. If all it took was believing in Jesus and God, 60% of Americans would be in heaven. Guess what? Not going to happen. Matthew chapter 7, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says, few there will be that find it. Not everybody's going to heaven. So it takes more than just believing in Jesus and God, like 60% of Americans. It says go beyond that and exercise your faith. Did you know who was called the father of the faithful in the Bible? Abraham. Do you remember him being called that? Father of the faithful. Why? Not because he believed in God, but he did what God told him to do. If Abraham had not picked up his family and left the land of Ur to go to the land of Canaan, then he would have not been called the father of the faithful. But he was, because he did what God said. So it takes more than just believing in God and Jesus. We have to also exercise our faith. And finally, we need to keep a strong faith and realize what that's all about. And a great church will stay alive. That's what he wants us to do. Stay alive. Let's not just be a great church, but let's stay alive. Hypocrisy and decay in religion are the sins charged against the church in Revelation chapter 2. After telling them how great they were, he said, I have a problem with you. You're not alive. He knew the church, he says. I know your deeds. I know the church in Ephesus. And he knows the church in Lincoln Park. But he wants us to be busy. He wants us to be alive. The purity of doctrine, the unity among ourselves, the uniformity in worship, the decency with our morals, and all of these things, the order that we have, God wants us to make sure that we're concerned about the church. And we want to continue to have a church here at Lincoln Park that's alive, not dead. Let's not be like those cathedrals in Europe. Let's not be like the churches in Europe. Let's not be like the basilicas in the churches in Europe. Let's be a church that's alive. So what is our closing statement? That is, any philosophy that makes a church great, which excludes any of these qualities that you've written down on that outline, is misguided and wrong. If we're not doing what the Bible tells the church in Ephesus to do, we're wrong. Now, for a moment, just before we sing this song, I want to ask you, is there something in your life that's amiss? Is there an area out of one of these eight areas that you're falling short in your Christian walk? Then we want you to repent this morning. Remember how you were when you came out of that baptistry. Repent, change, and finally, go back to doing what you did in the beginning. Redo it. Become a passionate Christian who exemplifies our faith. If you aren't, we ask you to come forward. Let's stand together and sing.
Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still, have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Wider than snow, Lord, wash me now, as in thy presence humbly I bow. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Order my being, absolute sway. Fill with thy spirit, till I shall see Christ only always living in me. Thank you once again for assembling with us this morning. Before the Lord's closing prayer, a quick reminder and a clarification. When we receive our messages from Dave on our phone call outs, letting the congregation know what's happening during the week, we want to clarify some things. One, we want this congregation to be the safest congregation in the world, and it is. And there's been some misunderstanding because when an announcement is made that someone has coronavirus, it's not the assumption that there's a member that's assembling with us. It's usually someone remote, their family members who want their prayers. And some of the congregations that I've talked to this past week in the congregation dropping off cards thought that the people were in the actual building, and they're not. So we just want to make sure there's a clarification that we won't assemble if we know there's an issue with the virus among the family. We'll make provisions for that, and if you communicate that to us, we'll make sure it's communicated properly, and we'll make sure you remain safe. So we have not had an official assembly like that at all, but we have made provisions for to not assemble when it came about. So just be confident when you assemble that we're doing the right thing, that you're doing the right thing, and we can continue to meet the way we are. Now we will have Brother Jacobs give us our closing prayer.
Well, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for letting us all gather here today on this day to praise you and your Son. Look after all of our members, brothers and sisters, that are asking for your prayers today, and even those who haven't came forward and who need your prayers and guidance, give them your guidance. Look after us all as we partake the day and move on forward into this oncoming new year. Please look after all of us, and please, only in your power, that you get rid of this coronavirus that we've all been dealing with for this last year, so that we can all gather again and worship together. And in Jesus Christ, amen.